say definitively that religions are all bullshit.
Welcome to Brainstorm.
We have the explicit tag for a reason.
This is a base level argument to a higher level morality.
I get paid to science?
To science as much as one can science. What the hell was my point?
Trigger warning. The Brainstorm podcast will criticize your most cherished beliefs. We attack nonsense in all its forms and discuss difficult subjects. If you peddle pseudoscience, supernatural woo, or religious dogma, then this is not your safe place. It's the home of hardcore skepticism.
Hi, and welcome to Brainstorm Podcast. This is episode 47, and today is June 10th, 2016. I'm Corey, and my panel tonight are Destin, Renee, Angela, and Leo. I didn't give you guys a chance to say hi.
Hi.
Hello.
Welcome, everybody.
With the always amazing Dave doing sound.
Hoo-ah.
And we're here in Roman Empire Studios in Regina, Saskatchewan. Tonight's show is brought to you by Reasonist Inc., atheist, skeptic, and science-based apparel. You can find them at reasonistinc.com. We've got another great guest for you as soon as he can get his audio issues figured out. Michael Sherlock is an author, blogger, speaker, and atheist activist. One of the founding members of the Human Rights for Atheists, Agnostics, and Secularist organization, and is active in the global movement to remove all blasphemy laws. But we will chill out for a few minutes while... he gets his audio issues figured out.
Also, one of the first interviews we did.
Yeah, he was one of the first three, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, and wow. This is our
and our favorite repeat.
And our favorite. That's right.
Really? Cool.
And so
dead air. We like dead air.
Yeah. Well, yeah. It looked like he might have us going there for a second.
It's okay. We can fix that in post in a live show.
My question is, how come we don't have Teresa Caputo in studio today? Why is?
Yeah, is she here already?
Oh, geez, eh?
You know why? Because she's psychic and she knew. She knew better. She roasted.
She knew. Yeah. We got some reaction. Michael's here.
We got to get a
we can hear you sort
bit
of.
Louder audio here.
We're turning up.
Yeah, we're good, guys. Go for it.
Are we good?
Yeah.
Yay.
Can somebody turn up my... I think I'm the number two.
So... Okay.
We got here early, even.
Yeah, we were here earlier.
There, now we can hear Michael.
Hey, yeah, Michael.
Got me?
We got you.
Hey, man.
Do you have us?
I have you. Visual and audio.
Perfect.
Cool.
Perfect.
You've got something on your shirt.
Yeah, it's a big A thing. I wore that to work today.
It's Corey saying he is a
theist.
You're a theist. That's good enough. Yeah.
Some hicks might think that was the case.
What? Or he's a Star Trek guy.
Yeah.
Or he's a theist, eh?
A theist, eh? That's a different A. So how's it going, Michael?
Yeah, it's good, man. It's good. It's getting really hot here in Japan at the moment. So
is that right?
Is it really humid?
Hanging out at the beach.
Oh, nice.
Nice. You guys do Celsius over there?
Yeah.
Yeah, what degrees? How hot is it?
Hot.
Oh, good enough.
I don't have a thermometer right now. Yeah. It's pretty hot.
So like somewhere between 30 and 70. Yeah.
But yeah, roughly.
I think we got up to 29 today, which is hot.
Yeah,
but
that's pretty hot.
What's that?
Where are you guys?
We're in Saskatchewan, in Canada.
Okay, I thought that was really cold.
Yeah. We were actually the hottest place in the country today.
See, we are, during wintertime, it's super freezing. But during summertime, it gets super hot. We're like,
extremes.
We're the menopause of Canada.
The menopause.
It's really dry.
Itchy.
And cold.
That's disgusting.
Get moody from time to time.
Claire in the chat says that it's 18 degrees in Sydney right now.
Yeah, but it's winter
beautiful.
There.
That's a pretty nice winter.
That's gorgeous.
I'll dump beer on myself.
Did that land in your lap?
It did so.
Only cool people pee their pants.
It's going to be all one right. of those. No.
So we're off it's going to be one of those.
A rock and start here. So I did introduce you already. I mentioned that you are one of the founding members of the Human Rights for Atheist, Agnostics, and Secularists organization.
Yep.
Is that still going on? What are you guys up to with that?
It is. We're really quiet at the moment because, well, I'm trying to single-handedly steer that ship. And also I've got my studies. I'm doing a master's in religion and I've got, work commitments, all sorts of things going on at the moment. So I'm waiting. I'm trying to get more volunteers to help with that organization. And we're also trying to raise funds to get an international lawyer so we can approach the UN.
Oh, wow.
So
we've got, I've got a lot of balls in the air at the moment.
Yeah.
How would somebody contact you to become a volunteer?
Well, you can contact me on Twitter or Facebook, and I think my email is available on my website. If you go to my website, you'll see my email and contact and stuff like that there. It should be there. But there's numerous ways.
Sorry?
There's numerous ways you can get in contact with me.
Okay.
No, perfect. I guess you kind of mentioned it. You've been doing your master's since the last time you were on the show?
Yeah. From the University of New England in Sydney via correspondence.
Oh, cool.
Oh, wow.
So you've just started the master's program?
No, I'm almost finished. I'm halfway through. So the hard bit's over. Now I've just got two master's research papers to go on Islam and Christianity, and then just one last semester of two subjects, and I'm done.
Yeah, I was going to say I'd like to read your two final papers when they're published.
Yeah.
That'd be cool.
I've been having difficulty finding a supervisor for the one on Islam, as you can imagine.
Right.
Yeah.
Maybe because my thesis or my proposition is that you can locate many of the behaviors of ISIS in the Quran and the Islamic Hadith. And so Islamic scholars aren't too keen to try and take me under their wing.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
They might try and dodge that a bit, hey?
I mean, that has been tackled in other places, but not probably at the university level.
Yeah, that's what I want to do. I want to bring that debate into the university. I think it's an important debate to bring into the university. Something that a lot of people are deliberately kind of ignoring, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it sure seems like it. Like, that'd be the
pretty
taboo topic.
Yeah, I've got one supervisor lined up, and he might be good to have as a supervisor, but I'll see how it goes.
Wow.
Yeah, and the other research paper is on the Jesus myth theory. Looking at the arguments for and against the Jesus myth theory.
Oh, yeah.
So that's the other paper I want to get done.
Yeah, mythicism is kind of a big topic these days.
It is socially, but it's not so much in academia. It's becoming increasingly so. There is a shift in secular scholarship, but I think there needs to be a bigger shift, and that's what I want to try and bring to that area as well.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So would you classify yourself as a mythicist then?
No.
No?
Not a historicist either. I'm agnostic with regards to the historical Jesus and atheist with regards to the magical son of a fairy.
Yeah. Those both seem like reasonable positions.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like there are numerous arguments on the historicist side that are fairly credible and fairly good arguments. And there are very good arguments on the mythicist side as well.
Right.
And when you're dealing with ancient history, you're not dealing with the pure sciences, so you can't deal in certainties.
That's right.
And yeah.
So to say that Jesus didn't exist, you can't actually make that statement when it comes to ancient history. To say that he did exist, well, there's not enough evidence to support that claim either. So I guess you could say I'm agnostic with regards to the historical Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
It's fair to kind of withhold judgment on the subject.
Some people would disagree.
Wow, so it's kind of hard to get primary sources from 2,000 years ago.
Yes.
So if I may ask, what would you say is one of the, or a couple of the biggest, I guess, evidences for the mythicist argument? Like, or what are a couple of the arguments that are the strongest?
Well, there's a lack of contemporary sources is one of the biggest ones. The closest sources that we do have for Jesus come from biased sources, so they suffer from bias. They're also entangled with myth. And you look at Hegel's philosophy of history, for example, myth and superstition should not be considered original history because it's myth and superstition. It's this bullshit. And so you can't trust it to be classified as history. And history only deals in the most probable claims, what probably happened. And considering the fact that, well, someone returning from the dead is an improbable scenario, history doesn't have access, doesn't have the tools to access those kinds of claims. So a lot of the gospel testimony and things like that, you can't even call it history because it's myth, it's superstition, it's nonsense. So you have to scrape all that away before you start looking at the historical, I guess, cause in there, if there are any historical cause in there. And when you start looking at those historical cause, there's a lack of contemporary sources, they suffer from bias, there's arguments from similarity, that is like many of the myths and stories about Jesus are found in earlier pagan gods and you know, demiurgs. And so there's a lot of problems with the historicist position, and the mythicists have raised the concerns quite a lot. But now that, thankfully, that's moving into scholarship, that's moving into the universities, and so it might get taken a little more seriously, I think, these arguments.
Right.
And it's no surprise, like one of the arguments that historicists always use is, well, look at the scholarly consensus. You're an idiot if you go against the scholarly consensus. And I say, okay, well, let's look at the consensus. Where is it coming from?
Yeah.
What scholars?
Mm-hmm.
They're all Christians. They come with a pre-established belief that Jesus is this and that, and they're essentially, it's confirmation bias laced consensus.
Yeah.
And so we need to take it out of religion so that we can look at it a bit more critically. And if there was a historical Jesus, we do that. There certainly wasn't a historical wizard. I think we can say that with fair degree.
A reasonable amount of certainty.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And so, yeah, I think, yeah, historicists have a very steep hill to climb to try and prove a historical Jesus. And even if they can show good evidence for it, even then you're dealing with the uncertainty of ancient history.
So my follow-up question to that. A couple of intelligent people were recently talking about evidence. And what kind of evidence would you need to support the existence that Jesus did exist historically? And would it have to be regular evidence or would it have to be extraordinary? Not that I think that there is such thing as extraordinary evidence, but because evidence is just evidence. But I'd like to hear your take on that.
You're such an ass.
We were just talking about this.
Why isn't that in the intro?
Because we say it every episode.
Personally, you wouldn't be able to prove that historical Jesus exists. You'd only be able to show that it was likely that historical Jesus existed. You would need more contemporary sources that were from non-Christian sources. This is one of the main things you need, I think. Now, we have Josephus, but he's removed at least a generation from, you know, Jesus, or the supposed time of Jesus. You have testimony from, like, Tacitus and other Roman historians that are, again, removed in time. And also those Roman sources don't talk about, well, they just talk about the existence of Christians and their leader, Christus or Christ, And that's just really relaying what people believed in the time, and that doesn't really testify to the historical Jesus. It testifies to the fact that there were Christians who followed a figure, Christ, depending on the source, usually Christ or Christus or Christus. And so you need a lot more contemporary sources that are not biased and not infused with superstitious nonsense. Or even if they are infused with superstitious nonsense, the historical datum inside that testimony needs to come from unbiased sources.
For sure.
I think that would be a lot more convincing.
Mm-hmm. Did you happen to watch the National Geographic program, The Story of God, hosted by Morgan Freeman? Did you hear that?
No, I think I might have been washing my hair that day.
I had to watch it, whether it was an exercise in futility or not, but there was a lot of, like you said, there has to be unbiased sources. There was a lot of biased sources because they had historians, but they were Jewish historians, and, you know, they were taking Morgan to all the holy places, and I mean, it's relatively impossible to be unbiased because that's the religion that they practice.
Yeah.
And these same historians, they use the Gospels as historical testimony.
Exactly.
But the problem with that is, A, we just talked about it, bias, and B, there's conflicting information in there with regards to historical details.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Quite a lot of contradicting material in there. And also, it's quite evident that the people who wrote those were obviously not Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, as the traditions have come down to us. And when you start looking into who may have or may have not written these documents that became the Gospels later on, you start seeing that these people weren't familiar with the land they were writing about. Mm-hmm. They made mistakes with regards to where towns were. For example, Bethany in the east. Bethany's not in the east, but anyway. And so there's a lot of different problems with the sources that we have if you want to use the Gospels as sources.
Yeah.
There's a lot of internal, intrinsic historical problems with those sources.
And one thing that they pointed out in that program that I found interesting as an atheist, there was a woman that made the claim that in the book of Revelation they talk about the Antichrist and the number 666, and one historian that they spoke to theorized that it was Nero
that they were describing.
Because he was really not a friend of the Christians, and that's who he was describing, which I thought was really interesting.
It's a good hypothesis because a lot of the, if you read a lot of the stuff that Jesus allegedly said, he talks about you'll be persecuted, you'll be this, and it's almost as if they're writing it in the future, but referring to it as it happened, like as if he's saying it in the past.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of emphasis on this persecution, which Christians weren't so much persecuted in Jerusalem. Well, they were kicked out of the synagogues, etc. Mm-hmm. By the Jews because of the heresy of their beliefs, and we have quite good testimony for that from Jewish sources and Christian sources. Both sides testify to that situation, and that's quite prevalent in John, which is why John is the most anti-Semitic of the Gospels.
Okay.
Which could be a backlash against them getting kicked out from the synagogues, mm-hmm. getting evicted from the synagogues. But there is a lot of talk of this persecution. And also, when you look at how scholars date Mark, for example, which is now believed to be the earliest gospel, they date it post-70 CE. Post-70 CE is after the persecution of Nero. So if the earliest gospel is dated to after the persecution of Nero, it makes sense why Jesus is talking quite a lot about you'll be persecuted in my name and da-da-da-da-da.
Mm-hmm.
And that 666 thing, they do a little numerology kind of there's a little numerology to that kind of gig.
Mm-hmm.
Not numerology per se, but they try and equate the number to Nero's, I think, the alphabet in his name,
yeah,
or something.
Exactly.
Yeah. And so that may or may not, because it is quite a symbolic book, the Book of Revelations. It was certainly written by someone who had eaten a few mushrooms, I think.
Yeah,
no
kidding.
Doubt, eh?
Yeah, or it's been out in the sun too long, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, I'm not convinced about the Nero argument, although it certainly could be. It makes sense that Nero would be the Antichrist in that situation.
I just found it interesting that it was a historical figure, that somebody like, and so many people take it literally, like it is yet to come, and it's, I mean, this they're essentially talking about what has already happened.
Yeah. Well, if you look at the origin for the term Lucifer, the fallen one, or the Lux Ferro, the light bearer, it's talking about the king of Babylon, who was a historical figure. Uh-huh. And Babylon, as you probably know, invaded and mm-hmm. took the Jews captive. And before then, there was an Assyrian exile as well. And so it makes sense that they're dramatizing these historical figures who have done them wrong and mythologizing them to be these epitomes of evil.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because
supernaturalizing the story. And it's quite a common thematic, I guess. What's the word I'm looking for? It's quite a common technique used in that kind of writing.
Okay.
Because Lucifer is nowhere referenced as Satan. Like that is a total manufactured idea, because the origin of the fallen one, it only refers to the Babylonian guy. So yeah. in where it comes from, it only references, you know, one of the sons of Babylon. You know, he was too arrogant and too full of himself, and he was knocked off of his throne. That's where the whole thing comes from.
Hmm. And it specifically says he is a man.
Yeah.
And he will be buried in the ground with the other king.
Hmm.
It's obviously referring to the king of Babylon.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
That is interesting.
But I have never been able to figure out, and I did my first degree in religious studies, and that was one thing I could never get an answer to, why there was a Satan when there was absolutely no connection other than somebody being arrogant and full of himself and then being thrown down from his throne.
Yeah,
and
there's no favorite son of God or anything.
Yeah,
like that.
So, and one of my professors actually said, "Well, yeah, there's absolutely no reference in the Bible or any other book that is actually referring to Satan."
Hmm.
Yeah, exactly. That's right. And if you read most competent Bible Bible commentaries mm-hmm. From Oxford, from Cambridge, they're really good ones. They expressly say that there's no justification for Satan in the Old Testament as Christians view him. He's not the serpent in the garden. The serpent in the garden is just a cunning beast of the field. And I just sent you guys a link to, you. I don't know if you've read it, an article I wrote or a big piece I wrote called Debunking the Devil. And I go through all the information and show how the Jews took the dualism of the Zoroastrian religion, because mm-hmm. you understand that, you know, the Persians freed, they say Cyrus freed the Jews from Babylon, but there's a lot of historical problems with that claim. But the Persians nonetheless conquered Babylon and the Jews were freed, and the Persians helped the Jews build the second temple. And a lot of Persian theology and mythology came into Judaism in the Second Temple era. And one of the main aspects, I think, that came in was the dualism of the Zoroastrian religion. You had a good God and he equally powerful, not quite equally as powerful, a dark opponent. And there was this dark and light motif. And prior, if you read Isaiah, which was written in around post-exilic time, Isaiah specifically warns Jews about believing this kind of heresy, that there's a devil and a God. He specifically says that God is the creator of good and evil. God does everything.
Right.
And so I think a warning not to fall into the Persian heresy and believe God had a counterpart.
Hmm.
And there's quite a lot of good textual and historical evidence for that statement as well, I think.
That's very interesting.
It is.
Well, on that basis of thought, like, people blame Satan for things, and it's, if God created everything, then Satan's not to blame. He's just a really shitty landlord is all he is. Right. Yeah.
Well,
superintendent or whatever.
I've seen a few things where they've, to use the probably improper term, evolved devil, is went from, well, a fallen angel to, you know, basically, like say the story of Job, where, you know, Satan was to test this believer. He was still under command of God.
Mm-hmm.
And then as you get deeper into Christian history, then it becomes the devil, the equal but opposite of God. It's just something that has changed over the centuries.
Right.
Yeah, and a lot of Grecian and later Hellenistic mythology got put into Christianity as well, because you've got to look at where Christianity first arose. Mm-hmm. What were the cultural influences? Who were the main empires? You know, you can't take a religion and pull it out of its human context. You need to put it into its historical and human context and see what would influence it. Mm-hmm. Like if I watch a Bollywood movie and I see it's a throwback to a Hollywood movie, and it was created after that Hollywood movie, and it has all the same themes, all the same kind of characters, I can reasonably assume that that Bollywood movie is based off the Hollywood original.
Yeah.
And the same with the Christian religion, with the Jewish religion, obviously with Islam, because Islam is just a knockoff of Christianity and Judaism.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, yeah,
Another thing that is somewhat similar to the Satan thing is hell. The entire concept is also there's slightly more evidence for that one, but in the original text, it mainly references to the garbage dump outside of Jerusalem. Like that's the original word that is used in the New Testament for hell. And which was a burning pit, and I went to a lecture of a guy who talked about the origin of hell, and it was fascinating. Like he said, in most of the instances, it is, I think it's Sheol or something like that. That's the word used.
Sheol.
Yeah, I've heard that before.
So instead of Satan, the person who runs hell is actually the great junk heap, or what?
Oh, he's just a hoarder.
Madam Junk Heap?
He's just a hoarder.
No, from Fraggles.
Yeah, Madam Junk Heap.
The king and the queen.
Yeah. And if you look at the origin of hell as well, like you have the ancient Greek Hades, was influenced probably from Amenti in ancient Egypt, and also from the ancient Mesopotamian myths as well. The underworld was this dark, horrible place where the queen of hell basically ruled over and tormented the people with the bureaucrat by her side. And it was just a horrible place. And so I've written a little bit on that, the Mesopotamian origins, because I was lucky enough to take a unit on ancient Mesopotamian religion because I'm fascinated by them. But, like the Bible itself says nothing, there's nothing new under the sun. And I think that might be kind of subconscious. Our religion is just ripped off from earlier.
Yeah. That's probably the one part of the Bible that I've used the most. That and we know in part and we prophesy in part. And before I was actually an atheist, that's something that I regurgitated a great deal.
I tried to memorize numbers.
I know numbers. 1, 2.
Yeah, I was going to say, I can count to 10.
I was in Bible quizzing. I memorized a lot of the Bible back in high school. Lots.
When I went to elementary school, we had to actually memorize a verse every day. I went to a Christian private school.
That's right. They do that at Regina Christian School. They make you remember verses.
Jesus.
That's not brainwashing.
Yeah,
not at all.
Yeah. That's so depressing.
Trump should build a church. He should build a religion. Because it'd be the greatest religion. It'd be the best.
So why don't you tell us about your most recent book? I think it's called Blaspheming.
Oh, no, actually, I got one after that.
Oh, is that right?
No, I got a more recent one called 7 Parenting Tips for God.
Okay.
Nice. Tell us about it.
It's a book I wrote. It's a parenting book. Like it's meant to be sarcastic, and it's a parody. It's not a parody. It's sarcastic. It's an attack at the God as the concept of that he's this heavenly father. And so I have 7 parenting tips that I run through, and some of those parenting tips are drawn from my own experience as a parent and from experts in like child psychology and parenting. And so I did a lot of research that went into the book. And I think the best parenting tip is tip number 1, which is don't kill your children.
That's a good start.
Well, I think that's that's pretty much the foundation upon which we should be really working.
Yeah. That's awesome.
That's pretty good advice. I'm not a parent myself, but I think that's pretty good advice.
I always tell my kids that the only rule that really matters in our house is don't die. So not killing them would play right into that.
It would be you doing your job and upholding your own rules.
I think a lot of parents try to live through their kids, like vicariously. I think God just took it a little too far.
He was trying to kill himself.
By being his own kid.
I address what you just said in the book, that God's like, essentially, I diagnose him with narcissistic personality disorder. Now, I use a psychiatrist definition to run through and show in the Bible and how he acts and in everyday life, how this imaginary God acts as a father. And I come to the conclusion that he's got narcissistic personality disorder, but he's also suffering a psychotic episode. And I run through the psychiatrist definition of what a psychotic episode looks like. Right. And it matches his personality.
That's perfect. Freaky. Where can you pick up that book?
You can get 7 Parenting Tips for God on Amazon and Barnes & Noble. This is what I should plug. There is an atheist on Twitter that follows me. We follow each other, Lee. And her sister she got very ill. And so the doctor's bills got expensive. And the bank claimed her home or took her home.
Oh, dear.
And she's trying to... They're twin sisters, and so the woman that follows me, she's trying to raise money to get a loan so that she can get the house back from the bank. And so I'm giving away 7 Parenting Tips for God to anyone who donates. Like, even if you donate a dollar or anything like that, Lee will send you a free e-copy of my book.
Oh.
I really want to plug that because I think that's really important.
That is. I'll send you guys a... That's awesome.
Do you have a link for us too? We could share that with our listeners and post it in the notes.
Yeah, I'm just bringing it up now.
And you just ruined my joke because I was going to sarcastically say that I'm selling the book for $45. You just have to text me directly and then you had to go and be all noble.
I anticipated you.
Yes.
He's listened to the show before, yeah. So
he knows what to expect. Yeah.
When you guys were talking before the show, he's probably like, is that asshole going to be on? Okay, well, I'll deal with that. That's fine.
No, but I think I mentioned earlier that I'm omniscient.
That's true. Yeah, yes. You did.
Yes.
So be careful.
So at the beginning when we were having tech problems, it was just because you weren't ready to talk to us yet is what you're saying.
It's on my time.
He was simply testing our faith.
A day is a thousand years. It might take 1,000 years.
All right, here we go.
That's it.
Cool.
Yeah, so I sent you that link.
We'll have to,
I'll share it in the chat here, and then we can, I'll post it in the show notes as well.
Thank you. Yeah, I really want her to achieve that goal because I think it's really important.
Cool. Go ahead.
Well, I love David Fitzgerald's book, Nailed. It's kind of a lighter read on the historicity of Jesus and all that. Have you read it, and what do you think about it?
No, but we're friends on Facebook, and we had a little debate over the identity of Herod and some of the issues there, but I can't remember what the issues were now exactly. It was a couple of years ago, I think. But no, I haven't read Nailed yet. But I will eventually get around to it when I stop studying.
Yeah. That makes sense. You probably have a long list of books you'd like to read.
Yeah, I do. But the only thing I want to do at the end of the day now is just watch mindless TV because I'm so sick of reading.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, you're in Japan. There's a lot of mindless TV there.
I can't watch Japanese TV. It just drives me insane.
The game shows.
It's worse when you understand the language than the TV.
It's even worse. Yeah, at least they can make up what they're saying if you don't understand it.
Yeah.
That's fun, right?
Yeah,
that's fun.
That's
right. Like, oh, look, funny noises.
Yeah. I feel like I'm sorry if I insulted there.
Somebody.
feel like we were just very uncool.
Low German is a language full that's of unfunny racist. Noises.
Okay. Why do you seem to be the last person on Twitter who still uses the term regressive left properly?
Well, thank you to start with. Because I think for me, the way I identify someone who is regressive left is that they employ the principles of liberalism to defend fascism and totalitarianism by censoring and advocating censorship, by censoring people who are speaking the plain truth, the obvious truth, about religious doctrines that cause harm, that can be shown to cause harm. They conflate beliefs and human beings in the same way that the far right conflates beliefs and human beings. They just have another avenue of getting there. The far right do it by being bigoted bastards and collectively blaming all Muslims for the atrocities committed by, you know, a few psychopaths who, in my opinion, are correctly adhering to the scriptures of Islam. The doctrines of Islam.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think we would all agree with that.
Yeah, mostly, yeah.
You just need to read the Quran, you need to read the commentaries, you need to read the biography of Muhammad and the Sunnah of Muhammad, and you'll see that ISIS is the modern-day version of Muhammad and his marauders. However, the regressive left conflate humans and beliefs by calling people bigots for attacking religious beliefs, for attacking ideas and ideologies. And this is equally as nonsensical as the far right's approach. And so the way I identify someone who is a regressive left is they advocate for censorship of ideas and speech. They advocate for smearing people who speak the obvious truth about religious beliefs and ideologies. And they're just fuckwits, basically. So yeah.
It sounds to me like you've actually... are using it the way it was intended to be used. Like, I think the first time I ever read it was in Sam Harris Majid Nawaz book.
Yeah.
And I've seen it twisted quite a bit since then, this idea of the regressive left. And
well, I'm apparently part of them.
Is that right?
Oh, no.
Well, lots of terms get twisted and used improperly.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's true.
Yeah. I think it's because we employ heuristic shortcuts to thinking. You know, it's heuristic thinking. We stereotype. We need to make things very simple and uncomplicated. And so we're very subject to memeizing the world around us, to creating, putting everything into memes.
Yeah.
And on social media, this seems to be a big problem as far as I've seen. The regressive left has become a meme amongst many. And I think the same goes with this SJW thing.
Yeah. That was what I was thinking too.
Now. And, you know, I call myself a feminist. I don't advocate for safe spaces. I don't think a woman can be raped with eyes. I don't agree with a lot of the things that some feminists are saying.
Mm-hmm.
But I call myself a feminist, and I do talk about social justice issues. So because I talk about social justice, solid foundations within sociology and other social sciences. Because I talk about these, now I'm a regressive left SJW.
Yes.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Acknowledging inequality makes you an SJW.
It's just so oversimplified. It's so simplistic. It's like a child, the way the child looks at a world, you know?
Yeah.
It's even though I know I disparage children. Sorry, that's wrong. Because I have a 6-year-old daughter who can see much more nuance than a lot of these dickheads on Twitter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's more fun to see the world through the eyes of a child.
It is.
Sometimes.
Well, one thing that's been happening, and it's more and more noticeable, is media plays down to the base common denominator instead of trying to raise the base common denominator up to the capacity of media.
Mm. What do you mean?
Like stuff that gets released, especially in North America, like the Americanized news is so simplified and so over-dramatized instead of just releasing the facts and saying, this is what happened, mm-hmm. and just leaving it at that. Like the BBC is way better at doing it. Where they remove any kind of drama from anything that they're throwing out. But as soon as you start dramatizing it, you're just trying to get the attention of the lowest common denominator. And when everybody is trying to capitalize on that, because that's what's making the network, it's getting its followers and viewers and making them their advertising dollars, then nobody gets educated and everything gets worse, right? It's a systemic issue in there.
So what you're saying is the BBC have journalists and the American have juggling clowns.
Fear mongers.
Like that. Well, and it's not just that the BBC has journalists. It's the stuff that's happening in the U.S. doesn't affect the Europeans the way it does the Americans. So they can take a nonpartisan, non-left or non-rightish view of things because it doesn't affect their bottom line.
Yeah.
Where news that's happening in Europe, you get people that are all about the princess or the queen, and everything they do is huge and matters more than anything else. Where in reality, it doesn't mean a fucking thing, right? Same thing.
Yeah, I know. I've noticed that the American media is quite it's like a commercial in and of itself. Just it seems like more entertainment than anything.
Yeah,
it seems like they've, like you say, almost like they've hired people to make it look a certain way.
So I guess the point I was trying to make is, like you say, the one thing you want to do at the end of the day is watch brainless television. Mm-hmm. Well, the stuff that's supposed to be intelligent television is the most brainless television there is.
Right? When brainless, I mean, it's got to at least partly plausible and credible.
Netflix. Yeah, like Supernatural.
Or just The New Black.
Entertaining in some fashion.
Yeah.
Yeah, not news.
Mm-hmm. No laugh tracks.
Yeah, last time you were on, there was that show Selfie with Karen.
Oh, yes.
That was a really good show, but it only got the one season.
That was disappointing.
I never saw that.
It was really good. With Karen Gillan from Doctor Who. She was...
Oh...
One of my favorite Doctor companions. But
we can spend the rest of the night talking about Doctor Who. We should just carry on.
But the Doctor Who.
Right.
Doctor Who podcast.
can't wait for the next season. It's going to be awesome.
It is going to be awesome. So what else do you got going on these days?
Not much.
Not much.
I mean, when I say not much, I mean studies. Family.
Are you... sorry to interrupt. Are you writing regularly for Atheist Republic?
Not regularly. I stopped. I've just got too much... The study thing right now is just consuming my life.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm in a semester break at the moment and just enjoying going to the beach with my children and just spending time with my children, like quality time. So, yeah, no, I'm...
Nah, that's pretty good right there.
Yeah, that's great. It's great. Not much.
No, that's awesome, though. Well, I think that we will take a break and let you go. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
And we'll definitely want to have you back on next time you write something. We'll plug your show. And you can just pay us the same way you normally do.
That's dollar bill, right?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
It's all about the Hamiltons. That's a $10 bill. For the way that doesn't know that.
For those that don't understand.
Thank you very much for having me on, guys.
Well, thank you for joining us.
Take care.
All right, thank you. Bye.
Bye.
If you like what we're doing and want to help us keep the lights on, go become a patron at patreon.com/brainstormpodcast. You can hear the bonus half hour that we record every episode and get a shout out when you support the show. Become a patron for just $1 an episode at patreon.com/brainstormpodcast. Or you can support the show by ordering a t-shirt, mug or other gear from our store at caffeepress.ca/brainstormpodcastgear. If you can't afford to become a patron or buy gear, then why not give us a rating or write a review on iTunes or Stitcher? Every rating makes it easier for people to find us. Thanks for your support.
We are given one life, full of billions of small and large decisions. To be somebody, to change, to be kind, to give hope, to become a better person, and to leave a lasting impact on this planet. It is a decision to be made every single day while your heart is still beating. We've made our decision. Absence of clothing. Atheist and science-based apparel and merchandise, donating 50% of our profits to charity. Look good and feel good, without God. Check us out at absenceofclothing.com and find us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Pinterest for discount codes and other sweet swag.
Use the code BRAINSTORM at absenceofclothing.com and get 10% off.
The Atheists,
the Bible,
and No Wardrobe, the podcast.
Wait a minute. No wardrobe? You mean we're going to be naked while we do this?
Well, seeing how I'm an atheist and I'm reading the Bible, and since clothes are flammable...
Fire! Fire! Fire!
I thought it might be a good idea to take them all off first.
Naked or not, follow along as we read, analyze, and try to keep you from falling asleep as we go through this boring-ass book.
Find us on iTunes, Stitcher, and Spreaker. Who knows? We may even be on YouTube someday.
Hey y'all, this is Tucker from the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. And I might live in a beer can, but I ain't no inbred redneck. And if you listen to my podcast, I'm gonna learn you something. And no, I ain't talking about how to marry your cousin and not have kids with 16 fingers and stuff like that. I mean, I actually talk about real stuff and teach people where the Bible stole its stories from. So y'all give me a listen, would you? Thank you.
This podcast is awesome. I love how they've used the word fuck for every part of the English language. Didn't miss one. But if you really love the pervasive use of the word fuck like I do, when you finish up here, you should head over to my podcast, Unbuckling the Bible Belt. You'll get to hear me, Sharon Bush, and my co-host, Joe Kindick, fuck each other to death. Wait, that didn't come out right.
Like the last bit of that, it's...
That's all I caught. I was like, wow.
Somebody's fucking each other to death. All right. So let's go right into the woo report.
Woot, woot.
I'm not a scientist, but if I can tell you your science sucks, your science really sucks.
That just makes no fucking sense. I mean, it's just bullshit. Fuck.
And this is bullshit. According to the CBC... there was a couple who had a child with diabetes. And let's see, Rodica Radita expressed to doctors and social workers over and over again that she did not accept her son's diabetes. And as such, did not give him the insulin that was required. And did not give him the proper medical condition.
Treatment.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And $5. He recently passed away at age 15, weighing a mere 37 pounds. I'm not really sure what to say about this. Like, it's
so miracle diets.
Get diabetes.
Get diabetes. Don't treat it.
Don't get insulin.
Yeah, Alex was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes at age 3 when his family lived in Surrey. And after a bunch of being in the hospital over the next 12 years, in and out of the hospital over the next 12 years, he died in Calgary. And his parents are on trial with the Crown Prosecutor, Susan Pepper, arguing that they knew that this would eventually cause him to die and that they should be facing penalty.
Not the first Canadian parents responsible for their kid's death due to woo.
They didn't even really say that
they believed in Wu. They just didn't believe in the diagnosis. In their article, it wasn't as if they were like, well.
There was no real magic involved or like.
Just shitty parenting.
Just shitty parenting. Right off the bat, they violated Michael Sherlock's first tip. Don't kill your kid.
Don't kill your kid. That's right.
They should have gotten the book.
They broke the rule.
Yep.
Because they never explained why they didn't believe in the diabetes. They just said they didn't believe it.
Yeah.
In that article I read, there was a lot of attempt at government oversight on it.
Mm-hmm. Right. It just wasn't sufficient. Like, it just didn't actually save the kid.
Yeah. Well, the thing, problem is how much could they really do?
Yeah.
Because when I read the article, all I could think of is...
Well, yeah.
The comment threads I see on anti-vaxxer stuff where, the government shouldn't dictate what I do to my kids. These are my kids. Mama knows best, kind of thing. Yeah.
Well, obviously, Mama doesn't know best.
Clearly.
I think one of the things in here was that it looked like over the years, the parents have been faking the blood tests.
Yeah, I saw that in there too.
Which not only makes them like negligent, it makes them severely criminally
comparable.
How did it say how they faked the blood tests?
It's suspected.
Wow. Yeah, because they were required to show the test or not necessarily test strips, but they had to demonstrate that they were taken through I don't know how many different classes how to deal with his diagnosis. And they had to demonstrate it, I guess.
I can't find it in the article right now, but I think from reading it, I remember at one point there was supposed to be weekly tests to test if the kid had been getting proper nutrition and getting the insulin that he required. So
they were using their own blood?
Yeah, they were doing something, right? That showed the tests were fine. Mm-hmm. While the kid is whittling away to, by all accounts, 37 pounds is approximately what a 6-year-old should weigh.
Yeah.
My daughter's 50 pounds at age 4.
Well, there you go.
Yeah, my 6-year-old weighs like almost 60 pounds, so.
That's fucking disgusting.
Yeah. 37 pounds
is... Not that your son weighs that, but... But the fact that he died at 37.
Bad timing, right?
Yeah. Poorly timed.
We need to cut that and put that in the intro.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's disturbing. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Hopefully they get some kind of penalty, yes. But that's just my punitive... mentality.
Well, not accepting modern science as valid is woo.
Yeah, no, it is.
Yeah, well, once again, it's, I don't know, they didn't go into this in the article of why they didn't, that's one part I didn't understand reading the article is what their reasoning was.
Yeah.
Is it just, I don't believe in diabetes.
Yeah, they just didn't want to accept the diagnosis.
My son is not unhealthy. You know.
Lots of parents do that, though.
I've heard of that, where, they have it like morbidly obese kids and they're like, oh, no, there's nothing wrong with him. He's just a big kid.
Give him more chicken fingers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But like speaking as a parent, if there's something off with your kid or something where they have an issue, getting the diagnosis is the best thing you can get because then you have an idea of what's going on.
Yeah, absolutely. And then you can work with that. That's information you have that you can do something
which is,
with.
Which is the weird thing is because usually it's the other way around where the doctors are like, we don't know. I don't know. More tests.
Sometimes. Sometimes it happens. And I mean, I think you get the whole gamut of parents that are helicopter parents that are like, my child has the sniffles. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. She's got pneumonia.
It's totally Angela right there.
There's those parents. That is not me. My child is 4 and has not had a shred of antibiotics in her life.
Or vaccines.
She's caught up, actually. She's ready to rock. She's ready to go to school.
I'm just kidding.
Yeah. Or vaccines. Why would I be on the podcast?
That would be a newsflash. Ew. Holy shit.
No, you don't believe in vaccines?
It's funny.
We'll go to a break. We'll be right back.
You know, it's called manufactured drama. That's what it's called. We got to have that one person.
That's right.
No, I get it, because with Jen and I, she's way more of a helicopter than I am. Mm-hmm. Like, Loki has a matching scar to mine on his forehead. He fell in daycare and hit the Lego table and got a cut on his forehead.
Oh, ow.
And instead of taking him right to the hospital, they call me. I'm like, okay, is he standing? Can he see and walk and talk? He's good.
Is he
Just
dead?
Put a Band-Aid on him.
Is he dead?
Wow.
Yeah. No? Okay, good. Pick them up and brush them off.
Yeah. Yes. Rule number one is still intact.
Check mark.
Good parent.
But you get the whole gamut. So, like, to Renee's point about some doctors are like, meh. I mean, I think they get somewhat inundated. And the people, the parents that are, like, freaking out about their kid every time something goes wrong kind of tends to wear a doctor down. Right.
And
plug
up the system. Yeah.
And so the parents that are like super casual about, like my daughter on New Year's Eve 2 years ago, a year and a half ago, she ran into a door and sliced her forehead open above her eyebrow. And it was almost deep enough that I thought maybe I should take her, but I didn't. I ended up not taking her in because I just bought some butterfly bandages and taped her up and she's fine.
Yeah.
But
scars are cool.
Yeah. Make for a good story.
Claire in the chat says that they probably had it confused with type 2 diabetes and wanted to boast that no, our kid isn't fat. We're the perfect perfectest parents. We care about our kid's health. We killed him, but at least he wasn't fat.
Definitely. The thing about news like this is you expect this from southern U.S. states.
Yeah, that's true.
Not from Alberta.
Not from Alberta.
Although, obviously, there's been...
Not from BC/Alberta.
Yeah.
Although there's been more of those popping up. Like, I mean, that last one we were talking about with the... Oh, what was it? They only gave him natural medicines.
Yeah,
maple syrup and apple cider vinegar. And
ended up dying of, what was it, meningitis?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dying of apple cider vinegar.
That was Alberta, right?
Yeah, that was Alberta.
Super gross.
Gargle this, you'll be fine.
See, Alberta's also got a rising anti-vax.
Just add some hot water and lemon, you're fine.
Kind of community, right?
Yeah. Like,
Windex.
We need to keep one conversation going.
We're keeping one going over here.
The listeners are very confused.
Sorry, guys. Sorry.
Yeah, the host
I'm just
going
to start talking to myself here.
One conversation here, one there.
You need a ukulele or something.
Yeah. Dave's the only one
I actually play the ukulele.
Next time you have to bring it.
Nathan says, stupid Alberta. We don't really mean that, Alberta.
We're sorry.
We like you.
Well, Nathan lives in Alberta. He can say it.
Okay, yeah, he can say it. All right, so that's a pretty sad story, but we managed to make it a joke.
So yeah, we're assholes.
Kid died. Stupid.
We're assholes that way.
Yeah.
Listenership Leo. Down to two.
Leo, you want to take on some...
All right, I'm going to take on some woo. So this is one of the things that has been bothering me for quite a while. It's the whole idea of injecting hormones into beef, like to make them grow faster. And there are a shitload of myths that go around, you know, all the damage that it's causing. Pretty much everything is included in that list. But I came across an article, or this is an article about the scientific studies on the actual meat of hormone-injected beef. So they quickly run through kind of just the numbers of how much estrogen the meat actually contains. So they have, in the study they did a 3-ounce serving of normal beef contains 1.3 nanograms of estrogen. And in
the hormone-grown beef contains 1.9. So it is only from 1.3 to 1.9. So it looks like a significant increase if you just take those numbers.
Right.
Yeah, it's in the double-digit percentages of increase. But then they contrast it with other foods. Well, first they go on to say, well, even that, the estrogen is killed off by cooking and then by your digestive system. So it doesn't even really matter.
That's well within safe limits in any stretch.
It's minuscule in the effects because most of it gets destroyed anyway. But let's say even if you eat the raw stuff and your digestive system doesn't kill it, they contrast it with some other foods and how much estrogen they contain. And I found this very interesting. So 1.3 for regular beef, right. 1.9 for the hormone-grown beef. Okay. So I'm gonna read through the list that they provided of other foods.
Are these all 3-ounce portions?
They all of them are 3-ounce portions. Okay. So that was the study to keep.
Perfect.
Okay. So a normal child.
Organic or non-organic?
This is just general. It doesn't matter.
Say conventional.
Yeah,
conventional.
Yeah.
So I guess it's food, it's all organic anyway.
Yeah. A normal child produces 50,000 nanograms a day of estrogen, male or female.
Did they have a 3-ounce sample of
No. You need to do that now.
No. This is this is not only
it's like us versus them.
So please pay attention. A normal child produces all of the child, not a 3-ounce piece of it. All of the child produces 50,000 nanograms per day.
That's a lot.
That is a lot, eh?
A non-pregnant woman produces 480,000 a day.
So wow.
Not in 3-ounce portions.
Just off the top of my head.
Didn't I ask him if they were all 3-ounce portions? And he said yes.
Well, all the food items.
People can be food items.
All right.
We need to listen.
Okay. So from a normal portion of a 3-ounce steak being 1.9 or 1.3, a person produces well in the six figures, like an adult.
Yeah.
So it is just by that standard, it is irrelevant. Even if you injected that estrogen straight into your veins,
right, it's a drop in the bucket.
It's a drop in the bucket. So
wow.
Next up.
Sorry,
go ahead.
Did they measure like a man? How much estrogen a man produces?
The article does not have how much a man produces.
Okay.
So
I'd be interested to know.
Yeah. That was also my question, but they did not have. And I looked up the study. I went to their link to the science and they didn't have for men.
Okay.
But so, and now the list of foods in 3-ounce portions.
Okay.
For potatoes, it's 225
nanograms.
Nanograms compared to the 1.3 or 1.9. So potatoes have
just inherently,
have like
a bunch of estrogen, like
100 times more, more than 100 times more.
Wow.
Peas have 340.
Wow.
Ice cream has 520. Cabbage has 2,000. Soy milk. Mm-hmm. Soy milk has 11,250. And soybean oil has 170,000.
Mm-hmm.
And birth control pills have 35,000.
Yeah. Well, and it's interesting that you say the soy because breast cancer survivors, like they're not supposed to have
a bunch of soy products. Yeah.
It's a bad thing.
Yeah. And soy is very high in estrogen.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that is, but that is like thousands of times more than beef, mm-hmm. like ounce per ounce. Right. Mm-hmm. So that this study is basically just to show that if you're going to be worried about the extra estrogen in beef, don't.
Yeah.
But there's also, I mean, there could always be a scientific discovery that there's other things that the beef has,
mm-hmm.
but in terms of the actual hormones, that's all this study tackles is the estrogen is absolutely irrelevant
mm-hmm.
in the grand scheme of things because first of all you digest it and it it doesn't even enter your like your system, and secondly, almost everything else that you eat has more estrogen.
Yeah,
I sorry.
Pregnant women produce 19,600,000
per 3 ounces.
On average,
for 3 ounce sample.
I don't know if that's cooked or not.
It dies off when it's cooked.
It's blue rare.
It's blue rare.
Boys and men produce between 54,000 and 630,000.
Yeah. So that's somewhat similar to children. Like from you said, children produce like around 50. Prepubescent.
Yeah, it says prepubescent girls produce 64,000.
Oh, okay. Well,
whatever. Huh. Different studies have different answers.
Yeah, that's right.
But there's
a range.
Yeah.
So when people talk about hormones in their food, they're talking specifically about estrogen?
Well, estrogen is the main one.
Okay.
So like I said, this is a disclaimer. I'm not here to tell you that you should never worry about beef at all, but you should read the fucking studies.
Yeah.
Like go back and actually look into, and we're not going to go through all the different things because there's been many more done in terms of of injecting steroids and antibiotics and shit into,
absolutely.
Yeah. So it is good to go back and actually read the stuff and not get your information from, you know,
the press release
or from Mother Jones or something.
Yeah. Healthy news or whatever the fuck it is. Yeah.
But so it's always good to go back to the hard numbers and actually get a look at. And I was surprised. I actually stumbled upon this article, and this was, by the way, this is from the Lincoln University of Nebraska.
Okay.
So, and the study was referenced from the University of Michigan.
Okay.
So the Lincoln University did their own little study, and then they combined it with a study from Michigan State, and then this article was just a summary of kind of the digestible format, like where people like me can understand it.
Yeah, yeah, right. Exactly.
But yeah, I stumbled upon this article when my mom was worried about like, oh, you know, all these hormones that they inject into beef and shit, because my family, my brother and dad, they have a lot of cattle. So they, I'm like, you know, I don't think it's a big deal, but we were at the dinner table eating beef, and I am going to Google this right now because there was a kind of a dispute, you know, erupting where like, but it's got to have some negative effects, you know, all this estrogen and shit that you eat. And then I spent like 10 minutes on Google, and then I found this article, and then I, you know, linked the study and then, yeah. And I found it very, very surprising. I thought, I thought.
Well, there's even, I remember the essential oils, that's another rabbit hole, but but there's a mention of lavender, as you're not supposed to use a lot of that on babies or something, and I would be curious to know what the estrogen content of that is.
Well, there's other plants you're not supposed to use on babies, like wolf's mane.
Yeah.
Or like nightshade.
Yes.
Or poison ivy.
Yeah.
Or
hemlock.
Yeah, there's
Venus,
there's
Venus
a couple
fly traps.
There's a list of them.
Venus fly traps.
Really, feed me.
Feed me, Seymour. Feed me. In 3 ounce portions.
Venus baby traps.
That's a whole lot.
Baby size.
I'm never being allowed back on the show.
But well, yeah,
another myth with estrogen is, hormones is the birth control lets a lot of estrogen into our water supply because it doesn't get filtered out, right?
Right.
That's been talked about thing. But there's like your typical birth control pill has like 35 micrograms of estrogen in it.
Yeah.
Wow, 35
nanograms.
35,000 nanograms.
35,000 nanograms.
So, yeah, is that 35 micrograms?
Even myself, like somebody, I have a
history. And then an ultra low dose is 20 micrograms.
I have a history of pulmonary emboli, which is blood clots in the lungs, and I'm not supposed to take estrogen-containing birth control because it increases the risk of pulmonary emboli.
Isn't it
containing birth control?
Isn't
birth control?
I don't know that much about birth control, but isn't it the estrogen
containing
in the birth control that helps to control
The birth?
The birth can... Isn't that what makes it birth control?
Well, it's well, you can have stuff that only contains progestin.
Yeah.
Because to my knowledge, it's the progestin that mimics the pregnancy. So you don't ovulate.
It's a balance of the two or something.
Yeah, yeah. They do have both because you can... There's... like, and that's why they encourage, if you want like a lady health lesson, that's why they advocate like intrauterine devices or whatever, because there's no hormones involved.
Ah. Like a T-bar.
Exactly.
You're a T-bar.
And good for 47 years, too.
Yeah.
Another good birth control is being a lesbian.
Yes, that helps.
But I think I always go with the good and faithful, abstinence only.
Yeah.
But
abstinence only. That's right.
It works 100% of the time.
But yeah, in summary to this, until before we move on to the next one, yeah, I mean, the thing is, it is always surprising how much bullshit that people just eat up in 3-ounce portions.
Well, and the clickbait that they just read the headline and then they believe the headline without really delving any deeper.
So yeah, the whole idea of the Woo Report is to do your fucking homework.
Well, and that's exactly that's what right. Nathan just said. He's like, A&W's recent marketing is based on people's misconceptions on this topic. Yeah. Like,
and I always get pissed off.
Oh, when you see hormone-free eggs?
When I
hormone-free milk?
Yeah, and... It's,
or antibiotics.
Yeah, and when they market hormone-free poultry or pork,
yeah,
that is already illegal.
Yeah.
Antibiotic-free milk.
There is no antibiotics in the milk that you buy.
Well, did you guys read that thing went around?
Well, yeah.
About what happens if antibiotics are found in milk?
They have to dump the whole truckload.
Yeah. And then they find out which farmer had the antibiotic in their milk.
They charge him.
And he pays the entire truckload.
Let's not to equate the hormone and the antibiotic things are two different things.
Different
scenarios. So this is not any kind of comment towards the antibiotics. That's a whole different study that you have to go read.
Of course.
But I think just it relates in that it's just like people think, oh shit, there's antibiotics in my milk now. Like they're not doing the research and they don't understand the incredibly strict regulations that the beef industry has and
yeah.
Duh. Rant over. Thank you.
Rant over. All right. Gumby, who's coming to town? Is it Santa Claus?
Please let it be Santa Claus.
It's about as legit as Santa.
I would argue that Santa Claus is more legit.
We could communicate with him if he's dead. Right?
So we need to kill Santa. No.
That is already on my to-do list.
Teresa Caputo is coming to town.
Who's Teresa Caputo?
Oh, she's a really stupid bitch. Sorry.
Bitches get stuff done.
She's sometimes a stupid bitch. I used to be able to do a really good Cartman voice. She is a legit person that can speak with the dead.
Totally.
He did air quotes there for you air listeners.
In case people can hear my air quotes.
She has a TLC reality show, so that makes her even more legit.
Is that still on? That's the Long Island Medium.
Long Island Medium, yeah. And yeah, she's coming here tomorrow. So you can either go see her or watch a football game. I'm kind of torn between the two.
Or be with, like can the rest of both? The province, go to Saskatoon and see Garth Brooks.
Or go see Garth Brooks.
Yeah.
Or protest. Don't forget that option. Protest.
How should we protest?
All the
How
events.
Do we protest football?
yeah, that's what I meant.
Protest Garth Brooks?
So She's like, what the hell's his name?
John Edward?
Yeah, she's like John Edward Light. She's not quite as good at it as he is. Because she's been called out and like disproven so many times. And
mm-hmm.
Like there's even been like, do you guys remember when, we weren't old enough to actually watch it, but on Johnny Carson with that magician, the mind bender?
Yuri Geller
with James Randi.
James Randi debunked him on.
Yeah, but you guys remember the awkward silence and him just being like all fucked up because he had no idea what he was going to do?
Yeah.
There's actually been episodes of her doing her thing, and it's just like that. It's just that painful to watch.
Yeah.
And stupid people still buy into her shit.
Mm-hmm. Lots.
And that's why I think I should start my own homeopathic fucking store or something. Because fuck these people.
You don't have a conscience then if you're going to start a store.
I don't need a conscience.
It's dirty money though, man.
If, as long as he says thanks for the money, as long as he doesn't finish that with sucker.
Yeah, you could put that on the receipt.
Yeah. Yeah,
thank you, sucker.
just call it sucker's homeopathy or like, something like that.
No, that's what I said. Remember, I said I was going to call it like BS pharmaceuticals or whatever I'm allowed to do.
But anyways, is that just a clever name?
Yeah.
So these are two things I took from her website. One is the disclaimer, and I'm going to read her disclaimer. That's actually really well hidden under her Google map in the bottom right corner of her website. It took a while to find it.
Okay.
Thank you for contacting Teresa Caputo by requesting a reading and or scheduling an appointment with Teresa Caputo. You understand and are agree.
And are agree.
That Teresa Caputo is not a medical professional, attorney, accountant, or other licensed professional.
Why is she giving any advice in these fields?
And cannot give medical, legal, or tax advice. Any information or advice given...
She does.
...is not to be used by you in place of any medical, legal, tax, or financial advice or diagnosis from qualified and licensed professionals in those fields. Readings by Teresa Caputo are intended to offer insight into your personal life and do not in any way constitute medical, legal, tax, or financial advice, which is what I just said.
Yeah. Right? But they have to emphasize it, right?
Yeah. Teresa Caputo will not be held liable for any damages resulting from the use of this website or as a result of any reading or appointment with Teresa Caputo. She likes to use her name a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Or any persons or events related thereto and or any actions or decisions that you are... that you may make as a result, including, this is all one sentence, I'm working on it, including without limitation, actual incidental and or consequential damages resulting from any claims resulting from any act or omission, negligence, fraudulence, misrepresentation. It's right in the fucking writing, fraudulent misrepresentation. or otherwise, including without limitation, this is all one sentence still, personal injury, death, loss of income, stress, emotional or otherwise, errors or omissions or otherwise.
So you're done now?
Do you need me to read that again?
Wow.
No, I would not put you or us through that.
They could just sum that up with, this is bullshit.
Yeah. This is the intro header for her website. This show is about my world, how I balance family, clients, and spirit. Many people have ask how it all began. My friend Victoria Woods felt that I was made for TV, and this was the perfect way to share my gift with everyone. Her sister, Courtney Moulin, and friend Jonathan Partridge, both producers, helped me make that a reality. So she just happened to be really good friends with people that can do TV stuff. Huh. Between TLC, Magala Entertainment, and my incredible crew, I've been able to share my life and amazing gift with the world. People ask, how has your life changed since the show? I say, only thing that changed is that I have both cameras and spirits following me now. Lol. She actually put lol in there. This is my favorite part of the whole thing. At the end of the day, I'm just Teresa Caputo, a medium... wife, mother, daughter, sister, and friend from Hicksville. That's the name of the town she's from. So her bullshit job is more important than her real jobs of being a wife and a mother, daughter, and a sister.
What I find funny, the puto in Spanish actually means man whore.
Yeah.
Like that's the... Yeah.
Yeah, because puta is whore.
Yeah. Like with an A at the end, that's a female whore. Yeah, female whore. And then with an O, that's a man whore. Yeah.
What does puta mean? And then she told me.
So how should we protest tomorrow, folks? I might be back from Saskatoon by then.
From the Garth Brooks concert.
I'm going to a funeral tomorrow.
Yeah, to the Garth Brooks concert.
No. That would be... No, I'm not a country fan.
It's probably equally as entertaining.
I don't know. Yeah. We did try to get a little bit of people revved up for a protest, but it seems like nothing happened. So.
No nibbles.
Yeah.
It would have been a lot of fun.
It would have been. Hand out some information on cold reading and...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe make some money doing some cold readings.
Yeah, shit.
Exactly.
I could do a
cold reading. She doesn't even do a lot of cold reading. When they pre-screen everybody, because before you can get a ticket, you have to give your name, email address, address, fucking date of birth.
Jeez.
Name of all your relatives.
Yeah, so it's not quite that bad. Hot readings, actually. Eh?
Yeah.
And the only people she actually talks to are in the very front row. Or from the front section, from one section. They're all in the same area.
And everybody else is just a spectator of the heart readings.
But I did a bunch of other reading on mediums, and my favorite thing I found on mediums was that that abandoned chocolate factory.
What?
I don't have a link for it, but this...
Tell me more.
This news crew made a fake website, or it took a website that exists for this chocolate factory, put a fake main page for them, like front page, with a picture of a fake person as the owner, and then they made a fake Wikipedia page for it. Of like this company was the biggest competitor to I can't remember the name of the company. They're the biggest chocolate company in
Hershey?
No,
like Nestle
with a W. Wonka.
Wonka.
Okay.
This is who they were competing with. And this guy got killed, trampled by a bunch of his horses in a stable and everything, and they hung this old looking painting of him in the inside of this abandoned factory.
Right.
And they walk six mediums through there, one at a time, to get their impression of it. And they were each giving a day's warning. And they all talked about how, I'm getting this feeling from this guy, Henry. He's saying, oh, the horses are killing me. You know, stuff like this. Every single one.
Things they could Google.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. That's all it was. And the one of them was a chick. She's like, yeah, I knew you guys were playing me. I just kind of went along with it.
Because she's psychic.
Yeah. Yeah. And one of them.
She knew they were scamming her.
One of them actually argued that it was actually the truth.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So that
begs, at least that one's a believer. They believe their own stuff.
Yeah, it's not that he's a believer. He's insane.
Doubling down on his shit.
Yeah.
So these people that do this are either, you know, criminals just trying to bilk you out of your money.
Mm-hmm.
But you should know that going in, that it's just entertainment. It's all bullshit. So there's nothing wrong with me opening up a business to milk people out of their money. And
in 3 ounce portions.
In 3 ounce portions.
Can I get 6? No, 3 ounces. That's it.
Why am I talking like this when I want to run for office in 3 years? And then the other people that actually believe their shit, and I don't know which person's worse.
Well, I think the liars are worse myself.
Yeah. That's,
because they're willfully misleading people.
Yeah.
They know.
If you truly believe it, you know, I kind of pity you. Like, yeah. It's sad. But if you're doing it just because you're a bad person, like,
yeah.
Then, yeah.
Although it's kind of
hard.
Subjective morality.
How many people are going to the Teresa Caputo?
Too many.
I heard it was sold out. So yeah. Brandt Center sold out is around what?
Depends on, there's different areas in the Brandt Center.
Yeah, but.
Is it in the?
It's probably going to be in the main.
If they say Brandt Center, they mean the hockey rink. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah. That you're looking at what, about 5,000?
I'd say something like that. Yeah.
That's a lot of fucking people.
Yeah.
A lot of people getting fucking taken.
Jesus.
There's another event too. There's a side event, isn't there? Isn't there two events she's doing around here?
Well,
she's going to Estevan too.
She's going to Estevan.
Yeah, that's where it is. Yeah.
Okay, for a smaller group type thing.
Well, they're all a bunch of stupid people.
Yeah, it is fucking Estevan, isn't it?
It is Estevan. If you're listening, Estevan, fuck you.
I endorse that message.
It's like Estevan is one dude.
Named you,
Wilbur.
Wilbur.
If you're listening, Estevan, fuck you.
All right, are we done with my crap?
Yes.
All right, I'm going home. Bye.
All right, see you later. Let's move on to some religious nuttery.
Just kidding.
Okay, then.
Cornerstone. This might be new to some of you. Scripture says that even our righteous deeds are as filthy rags to God. So even the good things that you do, even things like feeding the hungry and clothing the poor and taking in widows and orphans, as nice as those things are, if not done from the place of obedience to and a relationship with God, are completely worthless and disgusting to God. If you're not daily walking in a place of relationship to God, then the news that we have to bring you is that you're on your way to hell right now.
Yeah.
We need to change that stuff.
It's not going to change until we stop getting mad at it.
fair.
Right. Angela, you're up first for religious crazy.
I like to scroll through Pinterest from time to time and in between the workouts to get rock hard abs and or a really nice bum, I came upon Christian pickup lines.
These are awesome.
So I decided that I would go down the rabbit hole. But the thing is, Pinterest remembers what you search. So now I'm getting Christian pickup lines in my fucking Pinterest.
You should just went down the Karen port for the day.
I should have. But this was easier because I can do it from arm's length. Then I don't have to
see people in Karen port.
It's terrible.
Karen port is like a concentrated Bible belt in one little town for people that aren't familiar with
it. Briarcrest Bible College. Yep. Ugh. So,
I think we've talked about Karen. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I know people. I'm related to people that live there. So to name a few, I think I wrote down about 15 of them. The first one I came up with was Christian guys be like, I like my women like I like my Microsoft Word documents saved. You're looking for a knight in shining armor? I just so happen to be wearing the armor of God.
I already want to cry.
Yeah. Hey, girl, would it be breaking the eighth commandment if I stole your heart? That's terrible. Is it hot in here, or is it just the Holy Spirit burning inside of you?
Jesus. I don't know. I read through some of them. My personal favorite was the, I would say, God bless you, but it looks like he already has.
Yes. Hey, girl, you know why Solomon had so many wives? It's because he never found you. That's weird to me. That's not a pickup line.
But I just saw one. You interrupted my story. This one is borderline.
Turnabout is fair play.
This is like creepy in 3 ounce portions.
As though we don't interrupt each other constantly all the time. Man.
But it's, hey girl, is that a mirror in your Bible? Because I can see you reflecting Christ.
Oh, I didn't
I feel
find
like beating
that one.
Up everybody who says one
of these. Yeah, I would have beat up myself.
This is modest is hottest and you're on fire.
Oh my God.
I like my girls the same way I like my Bibles, fully covered. Baby, you're just like water, except Jesus turned you into fine.
I'm not sure what to say about this. Yeah, this is terrible.
I'm getting this weird gag reflex. I'm not sure what that is.
I'm not exactly single. I'm in a relationship with Jesus. Talk to him if you want me.
Oh,
my
geez.
Eyes are watering.
That's terrible.
You're allergic to bad pickup lines? Yes,
I think so.
Break it out in hives.
I put the stud in Bible study.
Oh. Claire in the chat says she's feeling violated.
You know what the temple veil and I have in common? We're both ripped. There's so many of them.
This segment needed a trigger warning.
Get your trash cans and make sure they're not quicker.
At least she's not using her super sultry voice. That would make it even worse.
Me? Yeah. I tried, but I can't. I can't use my sultry voice for those shitty pickup lines.
Oh, that's terrible.
Yeah, so there you go.
What do those pickup lines lead to? Just 1 year of abstaining?
Abstinence.
I'm confused. And then marriage. And then a shitty marriage.
Really awkward wedding night. Using cinnamon-flavored lube.
Oh, jeez.
That was disturbingly specific.
It's an actual story. That on the Removing the Fig Leaf Facebook page, there's somebody, it was hysterically funny. He and his wife both saved their virginity till marriage, and you should look it up because it's hysterically funny. Very humorous, kind of funny, sad, funny. Yeah, like, oh, that was totally me, and... No, I didn't save sex till marriage, but
I saved some.
I didn't use it all up before.
About a 3-ounce portion.
Yes. I still have my little promise that I made to save sex till marriage when I was 12. And then I wrote the date that I lost my virginity on it.
That's... I never lost mine. I know exactly where it went.
Yeah. All right. So that was worth a laugh.
That was funny.
Jeez.
I'm glad you enjoyed that. I'm
reading through more just for fun.
Yeah. I still feel like we should go beat up some Christians.
This isn't a hate crime. This is just punishment for those stupid pickup lines.
Fucking good.
This is justice.
This is your fault. It's your fault I'm hitting you.
That's so misogynist. Like, I like my Bibles how I like my women covered. Like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
It's terrible.
Trade Bible for Quran.
I was going to say Quran, yeah.
Yeah, it could be a
real covered thing. Except the eyes.
Yeah.
Apparently the modesty market is a booming industry in Saskatchewan, according to the news I watched the other night.
Is that right?
Modesty
market.
I did so not
what
know
does
that
entail? Like, what is that like for burkas, etc.?
It's high end, high fashion. Mostly they were talking like headscarves and stuff like that.
Okay. Okay.
So it's
I believe it.
Yeah.
So I believe it.
So it's very fashionable, but very covered.
Okay. So sure. Not like, not quiverful or anything.
No. Not quite that bad.
That's a little bit more denim.
Yeah.
Burka on fleek.
Shit. Are you guys finding any good ones?
Oh, too many bad ones.
Let's move on then. Renee, you have a story about something that's still funny.
A very disturbing, twisted way.
I saved my virginity for this art. I didn't even look at it because I wanted to be surprised.
Okay. Well, honestly, I started reading this one and started watching the YouTube videos, and I started sliding further and further down this rabbit hole. So I'm not even sure how to cover this one, but I guess I'll just go with the basics.
Okay.
There is apparently a guy on the internet. He goes by the name of Lord Rael. He has a website. It's amusing in a scary way. He claims to be the truly risen Christ.
Oh.
Nice.
Apparently, he, according to this, and he's got videos on both YouTube and on the website of when he descended into above Jerusalem in 2011. There's video of a UFO over Jerusalem. He claims to be that flash of light.
That's him, eh?
That's him. That's his flash of light.
Okay.
Neat.
And at that point, that's when he then went to inhabit the body of a righteous man in Illinois named Raymond Elwood Howard Lear.
Why did he go from Jerusalem to Illinois?
Isn't Don't ask these questions amazing? Because there more questions will get raised.
I get it.
Of course the Savior goes to America.
Because nobody would believe it if he said that the guy's name was Castiel.
This is the perfect... this whole story is the perfect mix of like the ultimate internet conspiracy. Because they tie in... Like you name it, Illuminati, Templars. He traces elements of like through the Templars, the bloodline of Collins. That's how he had to inhabit this body.
Oh,
yeah. And so basically, he inhabits this body, and he gives these pronouncements over YouTube in a very thick, but as they said it in the Vice article, dubious English accent. Like, it's a very thick, and it basically sounds like someone's trying to impersonate Winston Churchill.
From Illinois.
Yeah, but he's from Illinois. Yeah. Once again, don't start asking questions, because more will just pop up.
Mysterious ways, buddy.
Yeah.
We have sunny ways. They have mysterious ways.
Yeah. And he has, in all these pictures, he has, you know, has long flowing hair and a glorious beard and a white robe, of course, with the Templar's cross on it.
Does he have a hair bun?
No, he does not.
He can get one.
He can get one.
Sure, he can.
Amazon.
Yeah. But it seems brilliant the way if you tie in the Templars and Illuminati and shit, it makes you much more believable. As stupid as that sounds, it makes you more believable because people who are already believing that shit, they're like, oh.
They fixate on the symbolism.
And they make like little connections like, I know all this other stuff is true. And this.
The more bad shit it sounds, the more legit it sounds. Yeah. It gets better.
Okay. Please share. Because
as he's given these pronouncements about how he, as Jesus is, you know, it's all about love. He got rid of the Moses commandments and he only has two commandments.
Don't kill your kid.
No, he doesn't go that far. Thou love thy father, of course, through him.
Okay.
And love each other. But
those
are the only two commandments. But because we have a nun, he must chastise us. And he has warned us. Oh, how he has warned us. And so he claims every natural disaster since 2011, it was him.
Following him on Facebook now.
Well, you can be one of 8,000 followers.
8,000.
That's quite a few for.
Yeah, a crazy he has the International Congregation of Lord Rael is the Facebook discussion group. If you want to find it specifically,
there's an actual discussion group.
There is an actual discussion group.
He has over
7,000 Twitter followers.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh my gosh.
He's been around a long time. Yeah.
Yeah, and apparently some of his followers will actually argue with Jewish rabbis because he also makes the claim that that through the Torah codes or Bible codes, which apparently is a thing I did not know until I started going down this rabbit hole about there's codes within the Bible, there's a mathematical translation. It's very Dan Brown.
Yeah, that's how lots of those different guys that think they figured out how the end of the world or the date of the end of the world.
Oh, mm-hmm.
they apply these codes.
Yeah. You should watch the movie Pi. Actually, it's a Darren Aronofsky's first movie. It's about some of that stuff.
Okay, at any rate, some of this guy's followers will. There's a rabbi that apparently does a lot of this stuff. They will harass him and argue with him to prove that this guy is the real Jesus because of these codes.
Wow.
Now, where it gets weird is that when you look at, and I found a couple other articles, one of them was called Ross Story, where they started looking into this guy. This Raymond Elwood Lear is actually, and there's a lot of, if you go to the frequently asked questions, like on his Facebook, there's like he uses the same birth date as this guy and all this kind of stuff. And this is supposed to be the actual righteous man. Well, this guy at one point was part of the Guardian Angels, which is apparently a vigilante group in Chicago. The best part of the story was when he was arrested for felony stalking and conspiracy to commit confinement. He was trying to hire someone to kidnap his ex-wife. He was claiming it was to save her from her drug addiction and stuff like that.
What?
So he went away for that. And then when he got out on parole, he violated the parole and went away again. And now he's wanted in Illinois for some kind of – they have him listed as a delinquent. So it means he's violated some other minor parole violation.
Wow.
But he's now since started this.
Mm-hmm.
And it's strictly through – YouTube and a couple of these other web pages. And I guess there is an actual a retreat in Baja where you can actually go and hang out with this guy.
Wow.
Yeah.
Should we pretend to drink the Kool-Aid and go?
Just go for a vacation?
So far, apparently, there's been people kind of watching him and checking it out. They don't think it's a Jonestown situation yet. They're all relatively harmless.
Okay.
So far, so good.
So far, so good.
Wow.
But then again, all I could, as I was reading this article and watching some of these videos, because like he is like, you know, oh, and like there was one video and I tried to watch it again
to, you know, put it in context, like mm-hmm. just before I came to the podcast tonight, there's one where he's talking about how he's prepared for, like you said, chastisement of the earth, where he's got spaceships in outer space that he's going to bring down to, you know.
Wow.
I didn't know Jesus had spaceships.
Well, all I can think of is that line from Star Trek V.
What had I known.
What does the Almighty need with a starship? But
didn't you know he was an alien, though?
Well, apparently.
Obviously.
Clearly.
You know, that guy gets a lot of women. That's all I'm going to say. I'm just going to put it out there.
I bet.
There's a lot of sex going on.
Oh, you know it. He's got long hair and a beard.
The messiahs always get the girls.
A lot of eating of fuzzy peaches.
You know what? Gumby talked about using things for...
Yeah, that's right. You know, for financial gain.
For his gain. Well, some people use things for sexual gain. So.
Yeah, that's right. Jim Jones was getting it all the time.
Exactly. David Koresh. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like,
he's...
I need to get more ladies. What am I going to do? I am the actual Christ guy now.
Yeah. Well, no, and like that's just it. It's not like
line up, ladies.
It's not like this guy claims to be, you know, in connection.
Christian pickup lines.
He's not Christian. I'm the Messiah. Yeah. That's it.
Yeah. You can't really top that, but
it's the one you need.
This guy doesn't really just claim to be, you know, anointed
or talk to God.
Now eat me and drink me.
He claims to be Jesus himself. Although that is a new. Where was that pickup line?
I don't want to ruin it. If you're going to skip to it, are you going to go to the altar call at some point? Like how you can accept him as your Lord and Savior?
I kind of got off track. What was that again?
Well, it says you can accept him as your God by following, liking, or subscribing to his official website.
Really?
Oh, yeah. So that's all it takes, though.
Yeah. Oh, that's all. Yeah,
follow, or subscribe.
Gumby did it.
Gumby's
saved.
Yeah, he's saved.
If you go to his page, of course there's no overt in most of his videos about giving him money. But if you go to his webpage, there is a specific tithing link you can click on. There's a donations link you can click on. And then there's one on there which I didn't do enough research on it, but there's one about basically if you to get your marching orders, like if you're a member of the Knights Templar or the Hospitallers, and you know, there's he can give you marching orders to continue your roles. And I'm like going, I didn't realize the Templars still existed. I mean, in paranoia, yes, but not in actuality.
Real life.
Or Hospitallers. I know that they were a religious order.
To be fair with the donate buttons and whatnot, it costs money to have a website.
Well, this is true. I mean, I have to give them credit for this. I mean,
and also to buy all the Viagra you need.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, you know,
it costs money.
In his
it's
case.
Not free.
Yeah. You know, but. And it's not overted. There's just a little click. You know, you can do it. And he's not saying you must donate, you know, but.
Right, right.
Like, it was kind of a spooky rabbit hole. Because, like, there's a whole section called Christ Has Risen. Like,
nice.
And, like, it's not like he does good work. It's actually pretty shoddy YouTube video stuff. Yeah. But,
is that right? You'd think if he was getting a bunch of money, he'd
But as they said in the article, it's very memeable because like a lot of them are like stock footage and a lot of text and cheap angelic choirs and then this booming very bad British accent comes on,
nice,
which is like, why do you have a British accent from a guy from Illinois, and you're supposed to be the reincarnation of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like a weird accent to have.
Yeah. Well, they do kind of cover that in the frequently asked questions on the website. Not necessarily the accent, but the fact that he speaks English.
Oh.
Because the English is the uniting language. It's the uniting language.
I'm sure there's plenty of other people who would disagree with that.
I'm pretty sure.
Say what?
Well, and they would also disagree with the idea that Because one of the frequently asked questions is if you are the risen Christ, then should I continue to go to my church? And he's like, no.
Nah.
No, because church is only supposed to be there until
Christ returns and Christ is returned. So now any church you go to is now heresy.
Interesting.
Oh.
See, that's what they always do. They always do that. The one true church. Okay, if you go to any other church, you're fucking out.
That's right. Yep. You're done.
You're done.
Don't none of this tasting menu shit.
Nope. Yeah.
You pick one, you stick with it.
We're not a fucking buffet.
Yeah.
And well, then that's this whole
church
thing.
Church buffet.
All of his speeches are these
3 ounce portions.
These exasperated, I've warned
little
you.
Little shot glasses of
I
church.
Warned you. Yeah. Now I must chastise you. I am the one way. You know, it's like.
Yes.
Like, not in a super threatening way. It was kind of weird because it was just kind of a, it was like a dad that's about to spank you and he's just really disappointed.
Yeah. Like, I'm not mad. I'm disappointed.
Disappointed.
I fucking used that line, man.
All right.
But does he actually use the word chastise?
Oh, yeah. Several times.
Wow. It seems like an antiquated vocabulary.
Oh, he
I think he probably puts that on here.
Yeah, very much.
The bigger
so.
Words, they're going to listen.
Probably
me.
Most people that follow him have to Google what that means.
Yeah, what does chastise mean again?
What is he going to do? Is that good? Is that good?
Yeah.
I hope it's as sexy as last time.
Yes. On that note,
I'm going to chastise you.
Let's do some music. I've got some really cool shit, some cool heavy stuff this episode. We've played some songs by Third Ion in the past. Their new album, Biolith, is coming out soon, and we're on the promo list, so we got an early release copy.
Sweet.
The song we're playing is called Cosmic Delusion. It's one of the ones I like the most off the album. You can pre-order it at thirdion.com. And because we were on the promo list, we got a bunch of other promo materials from other bands. So I also got the pre-release from Astrakhan, and the song we're going to play is called Turgid Waters. And they're out of BC, and the new album is called Reward in Purpose. And our third song, we've got Eternal Lies from a band called Skeleton Wolf off the self-titled album. And I'll make sure as many links as possible to those bands and where you can get their music is in the show notes. Here's the music. Thanks for coming out.
My pleasure.
Oh, Viking metal's awesome too.
I love a Monomarth.
Monomarth is awesome.
A Monomarth is awesome. All right.
So welcome back. A Monomarth is awesome.
A Monomarth is awesome. Those bands were also awesome. I will definitely post links for everybody so they can check that shit out. We're going to go into Skepticism 101. We don't have I don't think we have the bumper for that yet.
No, I just made one up last time.
Right.
From Nacho Libre.
Yeah, that's right.
What are we doing? I wasn't here for a second.
Yeah, well, that's okay. We're doing Skepticism 101.
Okay. I was communing with Lord Rael.
Yeah, communing with your great Lord Rael.
Ain't no Rael.
Today's logical
fallacy. The Royale with cheese. Are you trying to say something, Corey?
I was at one point. Today's...
It's not your show.
Today's logical fallacy is ad hominem. Richard Ruff, you are now, Gumby is now part of the Lord Rael crew. That's the
really?
Best.
That's awesome.
That's the best.
No.
Obviously, they don't read anything that somebody was part of because, yeah.
Oh,
well, they're not listening to the show right now, so.
Well, no, it's Facebook. I might post the odd atheist type thing on my Facebook
Maybe
page.
The odd.
Yeah, but that's a discussion group. It may not. Or did you?
No, that's the official group.
You added them as a friend.
He joined the group.
Oh, because I think you have to post to the group, don't you?
International Congregation. I did. Yeah.
Okay. This could be entertaining.
Can that be a segment?
Maybe. We'll see how it goes.
I'll try to get an interview.
Yeah. That could be great.
That could be awesome.
All right. So ad hominem is our logical fallacy this episode. It's short for argumentum ad hominem. It's a logical fallacy in which an argument is rebutted by attacking the character, motive, or other attribute of the person making the argument.
You're an idiot.
No, not. You're an idiot.
No.
You're dumb, and therefore your argument is wrong. That's a... The logical fallacy.
I'm just too lazy to see the whole thing.
Where was I? Yes. Or other attribute of the person making the argument or a person associated with the argument rather than attacking the substance of the argument itself.
Oh, man.
Ad hominem reasoning is not always fallacious. For example, when it relates to the credibility of statements of fact or when used in certain kinds of moral and practical reasoning, I would say that the Natural News health ranger Mike Adams lacks credibility, and therefore it's not an ad hominem attack to say that he doesn't know what he's talking about when he talks about vaccines.
Might even be incredulous.
Might even be.
Maybe.
Maybe.
Mm-hmm.
A fallacious ad hominem reasoning is normally categorized as an informal fallacy, more precisely as a genetic fallacy, a subcategory of fallacies of irrelevance. Yeah.
I didn't know that.
And stuff. So,
sweet.
I mean, basically, we all know what this is. We've all encountered it multiple times.
Anytime I try to debate anybody that's, yeah.
Yeah. I'm often forced to curb my tendency towards it.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you mean? I give an example, a more clear example. We all got a little
like I said, saying that Mike Adams is an incredible source is not an ad hominem attack because he's not a credible source. But saying that... say Gumby once smoked a joint, and therefore he has no basis.
Just once.
Yes, just one time. Has no reason or isn't credible as a source to discuss cars, which happens to be his profession.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I see. You're wrong because
other reasons. Of who you are or where you are or something you did before or
yeah.
It's
you listen to country music, so you can't know anything about metal because you're an idiot.
Yes.
I don't know.
That
totally
sounds
fair.
Yeah, that's...
There's evidence to support this.
Yeah.
That's true, that's true.
Exactly.
That sounds like a fallacious use of the ad hominem. Yeah. Yeah.
of the... Yes.
Yeah, so...
You like sports ball.
Therefore, you can't skeptic.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. That's an ad hominem.
Yes.
Good thing I don't like sports ball. I just like soccer.
Yeah. The worst like sports ball.
I just saw here that we
totally
misnamed our podcast. So it's only been 3 years. I think it's time to rename it because there's the You Are Not So Smart podcast. So being the We Are Not So Smart podcast.
That should have been us. Right. Yeah, that should have been us.
Well, no, they're the You Are Not So Smart. We could be the We Are Not So Smart.
Yeah, yeah, well, that's right. Yeah. We should have been the We Are Not So Smart.
With an SMRT, though.
SMRT.
Yes, that's right.
That's a good point. It's definitely a good point.
The You Are Not Smart podcast is doing a really good series on logical fallacies.
Well, then we don't have to because they're doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. So actually, this was almost, this might be our last logical fallacy. I'm getting a bit bored with them. So I think we're going to move on to cognitive biases next time.
Talking to cognitive my ex is an example.
Somebody
wait,
use
wait, no, wait, don't stop. Wait.
Nathan says no, don't wait. Stop.
Which one, Robin? I just want to get that cleared up first before I agree with you.
I had a logical fallacy, and not this one, but
okay.
Somebody, well, the tradition thing, right? And I was careful not to be too aggressive due to my position, but
right.
But yeah, the idea that tradition for the bathrooms and for the national anthem and all this bullshit is why we should continue doing things like we did. Like the national anthem shouldn't be changed because tradition.
That's right.
So appeal to tradition. The bathroom shouldn't be changed because, well, I know there's the all the perverts apparently, but also there's also the tradition argument because tradition, blah, blah, blah.
We've always done it that way.
So there is a current logical fallacy happening nationally right now with people getting pissed off about the national anthem. So, it's worth continuing because people are still making these logical errors.
That's true. I was just thinking that there's still like 30 freaking informal logical fallacies. And in order to progress the show, we could go on to cognitive biases.
Yeah.
Well, and then there's the real minor ones.
There's
there's like a couple hundred more.
There's a lot of logical fallacies.
it becomes almost like from Big Bang Theory, know your flag.
Not that we spend a lot of time on logical fallacies.
This is true, it's just but still.
A portion of the show that...
Yeah. I think cognitive biases is something that is good to explore. Because that is a little more subjective.
Yeah.
And, yeah. Well, to some degree.
To some degree. All right, so now we're going to do Atheism for Dummies.
Oh, are we?
Yes, we are.
If you're not daily walking in a place of relationship to God, then the news that we have to bring you is that you're on your way to hell right now.
Oh, you're barking up the wrong tree, Meg. I'm an atheist.
I suspect that the Pope is an atheist.
I don't believe in God.
All right. I'm getting bored with religions as well.
Yeah.
I know.
In general.
So we're going to cover a couple really quick tonight and then we're going to move on to apologetics, the actual arguments for theistic beliefs.
Cool.
I thought these both of these religions fit well with the crackpot shit I was talking about.
Yes, with Raelism or whatever you call it.
Lord Rael.
So tonight's...
so sure it's crackpot.
Crack.
Wow. He's drunk the Kool-Aid.
He's drank the... Right, he's joined the discussion.
Somebody convinced him. He joined the group for 10 minutes and he's already convinced.
He's sold.
It's all a promise of sexual favors.
I'm giving him all of your addresses so that he can send you some information.
You guys, he's just going to send you some information.
Have you guys heard the word?
Bird is the word.
So tonight we're going to talk about Mormonism and Scientology, but only very briefly because they're both very
dumb. South Park, no.
Actually very small compared to many other bigger
That's
religions.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So Mormonism...
Size matters.
Size does
matter.
So does
bankroll.
When it determines how much time I want to spend on them, size does matter. Mormonism was founded by Joseph Smith in the mid-19th century.
Charlatan.
Great. Now Gomi's going to start talking in a bad British accent.
In the middle, in the northeast U.S., the largest Mormon religious body is the Church of Latter-day Saints. Because they couldn't come up with anything shorter.
No. They sell delicious oranges and apples.
What does that mean to you? It means somebody really wanted to spell out shield. Mormonism and mainstream Christianity share a number of common characteristics, including belief in Jesus Christ as a divine figure, belief in the Bible, and as divine authority, some similar worship practices, and a similar moral code. Though Mormons can baptize people after death, and
anybody can. It's pretty easy.
Well, that's true. But they do it as part of their practices.
It's a good way to get your numbers up.
Yeah, and apparently it's incredibly difficult to get your name off of their roster.
Well, especially if you're already dead.
Well, yeah. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
So on my thing, I'm going to have the do not resuscitate. And do not baptize.
Do not baptize.
Do not baptize.
That's right.
No deathbed conversions.
So I don't know how much I want to go into this. Joseph Smith apparently read some gold tablets that nobody else could ever find or see.
Because they were reclaimed by the angel Moroni.
He was using a hat. He was looking into a hat while he read them.
Yeah, and he
had special
had somebody write them down.
Is that special glasses, too.
Yeah, that's true. Special glasses.
Woo. I feel like South Park's up. Like I know I've made a reference to it already, but
yeah.
But I feel like that episode explained everything you need to know about.
Yeah, pretty much. And I mean, the creators of South Park have their own.
There's a musical.
Musical about Mormonism.
Apparently,
so.
It's awesome.
Apparently, it's great.
Cannibal. I've watched it like 20 times. It's awesome.
Cannibal.
No,
that's
no not not
the Book of Mormon.
No, that's a good one.
They also have Orgasmo featuring a Mormon.
Yes, Orgasmo was a great.
They like their Mormons.
Yeah,
they really do.
Aren't they Mormons?
I think
themselves?
They may have been raised that way, or
possibly.
I don't know. They're from Colorado. I don't know. There's a lot of.
I thought there was some kind of religious background there.
Could be.
If not
What's
current.
Is Colorado? Yeah, I don't know if it's got a lot of Mormons in it.
I don't know.
Or not.
That, normally, that's Utah.
Yeah,
Utah is very Mormon.
Salt Lake City, yeah, around there.
Well, when we interviewed Trey Parker,
have you seen Big Love?
No.
Have you talked to Trey Parker?
Well, that's your job.
That was a good show.
We pick up guests. You get a hold.
Never seen it, but I saw. I remember it. Yeah.
It's
Trey Parker.
Know,
2 weeks.
No.
8:30.
No. Not Trey
Parker's coming on the show.
No.
Matt Stone.
No. Although I have
Joseph Smith.
There has been a Matt Stone. Matt Stone
speaking through Teresa Caputo.
I'm sure I can get an interview with that Matt Stone.
Hey, Angela came on to a good idea. We could have Teresa Caputo on in studio, and somebody could have been speaking through her that we wanted to talk to, like
Joseph Smith.
Like Joseph Smith. That would have been fantastic.
That would have been a great idea.
Who knows what we would learn?
Well, we still do that. We just have to take that psychic course.
Yeah, we have to. It's going to expire.
We better get on that.
I got it. Because I didn't want to email. Anyways, we're totally going off topic.
We're going to join. We're going to take a psychic course anyway.
I'll take it by myself if I have to.
Yeah, you'll have to. Claire is saying that this is a good show, and I think she's crazy.
You're so kind, Claire.
You are.
So
she might
be
super crazy.
Nice.
She might be referring
sweet.
To Big Love or something or whatever. You
All right.
Oh, maybe. Yeah.
So also we were going to cover Scientology because if we don't, then we won't. If we don't tonight, then we won't ever. L. Ron Hubbard
L. Ron Hubbard
decided to make a religion in the 50s or something.
Yeah.
Well, he said
in the 54.
If you want to make money, don't do it by writing fantasy. Create your own religion.
Yeah, that's
it right. Also helped mm-hmm. because he was stoned as fuck.
Oh yeah,
his boast.
Yeah,
but when you look at it, Scientology gets results
because they're bullies,
yeah. Right? But it still gets results.
They like they force the shit out of anybody,
and they force people to work to the bone and bring in money. And
yeah,
it works.
It does.
They not very legal, but it's fucking effective.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so maybe quickly cover what is Scientology, even though that's really hard to do.
Can't really say that in a short.
Well, let's go with what
time.
Is on this religionfacts.com.
Because aliens.
Scientology does not emphasize particular beliefs about God or other traditional religious topics, yet it calls itself the Church of Scientology. And presents many of its teachings in spiritual and religious terms. Its teachings are highly controversial, with some regarding it as a dangerous religious cult or deceptive financial scam.
Yes.
They believe basically that, like you say, it's fucking pretty ridiculous, but Lord Xenu is involved, and there's...
The basic belief.
Dead alien souls inhabiting you and causing all the problems in your life.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's the weird part is the basic idea is that we do have eternal souls. And we through auditing and we eliminate the traumatic experiences.
Yep.
Of course, as you get higher into, as they call it, the bridge... That's when you start getting into the fucking Xenu bullshit.
That's right. You don't find that out until you're like almost at the top level.
Yeah.
And you're not supposed to anyway.
And you've spent a lot of money.
But you know the whole religion was, like you said, he was just fucked out of his mind. He's like, I got this idea for a book. So there's going to be this religion. And then he forgot it was going to be a book.
Well, yeah, because it was a book first, and
it
then
it started out actually as a kind of a alternative psychology,
yeah,
as Dianetics,
right. Yeah,
and then he got into then it sold like crazy,
yeah,
and then he got himself in shit over it being marketed as medical, like as almost like an answer to psychology,
mm-hmm.
And then that's when it shifted gears into a religion.
Yeah.
His great. Grandson or his grandson was on the Herd Mentality podcast recently, and he was telling some stories about the later years of L. Ron Hubbard's life and how he had to go into hiding and how mm-hmm. crazy he was and how I can't remember the guy's name that is in charge now.
Miscavige.
Yeah, David Miscavige is like a real power hungry dictator.
Oh, he's a total fucking power
pretty intense stuff.
Dick.
Like, but yeah, they believe in complete nuttiness.
Yeah,
they've somehow got a whole bunch of celebrities involved, and they are bullies who sue people. Who
is the most one of the most litigious groups out there?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
After Monsanto.
Well, that documentary Going Clear.
I
went to see that at the RPL Film Theater.
Okay.
And it was fascinating. It was immensely fascinating, as much as it was horrendously disturbing.
Right.
The influence that they had on people's lives and the separation of family members and, I mean, the things that they put people through.
Yeah, the whole disconnection and if they declare you an SP, suppressive person.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Well, and at the very end, I mean, they kind of they talk about a couple people that left. One of which, she was, I don't know if she was she was pregnant, and she was in a work camp, and she was eating table scraps basically, and. She went to visit her child who was in a shitty nursery, and her child was in a soiled diaper and just completely like being neglected. And she ended up going to somebody, the only person that she knew who was not a member of the Church of Scientology, and she was able to convey to her that, okay, I need to get out. And she set up an appointment, and somebody from the Church of Scientology had to accompany her, and then she managed to get her kid in the car and they sped away, and she's never been able to go back. But like stories like that, and then one of whom was like prominent at the top of the levels, she was declared a suppressive person. Yeah. And her kids are still in it, and she can't even talk to her grandkids or anything like that.
Sounds and, like pretty much any other really hardcore religion, right?
Well, we talked about one of them a few shows back, too, the girl that was in there. Same kind of thing.
Yeah, that's right, eh?
Yeah, her sister was in another city or whatever, and she got away when she was pregnant.
Yeah.
Well, I'm afraid she was locked up by the leader or something like that.
We're out of time. We're going to have to start our outro music.
And coming right up.
Remember Trey Parker, 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
I think we don't have any
just kidding.
Updates for the Shift to Reason, hey?
No, nothing.
No.
No updates.
Sorry, I've been sick for a couple weeks, haven't had a chance to
do anything. Yeah, and I've been busy as fuck.
But we are going to have another meeting of the executive so we can get everybody signed off. Okay. And we still need 2 members at large, I think.
Okay.
I think we have 1 and 2 more.
We will create a Facebook group for the members at large.
Well, for members ASAP. In general.
Yeah, or for members in general.
Supporters, yeah.
Yeah. All right, so we'll record another half hour for the Patreon page, but you can join us for the next live broadcast by watching our events on Mixlr.com/the-brainstorm-podcast. Or you can go to our website, brainstormblog.net, and check out the live show and the upcoming events page. Live show page and the upcoming events page. There are some upcoming conferences in Canada. There's the annual non-con this year in Niagara Falls on August 13th. And there's the AB Secular Conference on September 15th and 16th in Edmonton. I'll post links to the Facebook pages for those in the show notes. For Saskatoon listeners, remember that the Pride Parade is tomorrow. CFI members, check your event page on Facebook for the details on where to meet and when. We appreciate you listening, and if you want extra content from the live show, from after the live show, then you can go and become a patron at patreon.com/brainstormpodcast, or you can check the website brainstormblog.net and click the bonus content or support pages. We've got some new goals and rewards set up for patrons, so check those out. It's also great if you can write a review and rate us on iTunes or Stitcher. More good ratings make it so more people can find us. Thanks, Dave, for our intro music. Thanks to Alex Capper Murdoch for doing the voiceover for the intro and for some of our ads. And thank you to Jason Kamol for our outro music. You can find his stuff at alawstateofmind.com. All the music played in this episode is either with permission or under the SOCAN license to play. For more information on SOCAN, you can check out the music license info on our website, brainstormblog.net. You can also get Brainstorm gear at cafepress.ca/brainstormpodcastgear or go to the support page of our website. If you didn't get a chance to contact us through the live chat going on during the episode but think you need to tell us something, you can email us at mail@brainstormblog.net or go to the website and go to the contact page and fill out the form. If you have a podcast or a website and want a shout out or have a promo to play, let us know. We're also offering advertising to podcasts, bands, people, and organizations on the website. Contact us for rates and options. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you in a couple weeks when we have David Smalley. Not Matt Stone or Trey Parker.
David Smalley.
David Smalley.
He's fucking awesome, man.
Of the Dogma Debate podcast. Yeah. Thanks very much. See you in a couple weeks.
You know, this exit stuff is, that's like the half hour right there. It took like
2 minutes.
We just wanted
to say thanks to everyone who listens to us, shares the show, gives us a rating on iTunes or Stitcher, or supports us through Patreon and Gumroad. We don't have a lot of interaction sometimes with our listeners, but what we have had proves that we attract some of the best people around. Smart, kind, and cool. An audience truly worthy of the titles Hardcore and Woo Free. Thanks for helping us make the world a smarter place. This is an opinion-based podcast. Each person on the podcast is responsible for their own opinions, and those opinions don't necessarily reflect the views of the rest of the panel. Any guests or anyone associated with the people on the podcast, such as spouses, partners, children, other family members, friends, or employers. No one person speaks for the podcast, with the possible exception of Corey, and he doesn't speak for anyone else on the show. The Brainstorm podcast does not represent the views of our sponsors.